So I can't tell you how many times I wanted to sell a digital product or send over a digital product to somebody, have them fill out a form to get it. And there just wasn't an easy solution that had to change. So in this video, we're going to talk about what it would take to get that set up on AWS by looking at a completed project that I have already set up. To let you know what I mean by that, let's go ahead and head over here. And you can see the application that we're dealing with today. It's very simple in the fact that I just have a nav bar at the top. And you have access to the repo, and then you have the content that is coming out. I'm actually just recording and writing this today. And then you have the form. Now, this is going to be made with Tally. I freaking love Tally because it has a webhook integration, which means I can do pretty much anything that I want at that point. And it has a really slick, like Notion-like UI for the form building. And at the bottom, we have this footer right here. Now, this is a working application. So if I come in here and I say, hey, this is my name, Focus Otter, and then you can hit me up at ntlindo@focusotter.com. Then once I register, I'm going to get this. You can see my name is attached into here. I'll show you how I do all of that stuff in just a moment. But this is going to be sent straight to my email. And you can see here, we get this email, hello from Focus Otter Music. And then it has my name inside of here. And then it has a link to the song. So once I click on this link, it's going to play in my application. I don't know if you all can hear it, but it's definitely playing on my end. And there's the application end to end. When you think about what it takes to build something out, oftentimes you reach for a SaaS provider. But in our case, we're just going to use two AWS services and get this set up very quickly. Let's take a quick peek at the architecture and I'll show you what I mean. So we're over here and the general idea is that you have this application and inside of here, you have a customer fill out a form and sometimes you want them to even pay you as well. You can definitely do that inside of Tally using their payment block. Now on the back end, because the front end is super, super simple, we are going to be incorporating these AWS services. In particular, Tally needs a webhook, right? We're going to give our function a URL. Now Lambda has the ability to do this and we'll walk through how we did that in our code in just a moment. But from there, we're going to give that function the ability to get an item from the S3 bucket, namely this MP3 file that's stuck inside of this folder path. And then that item needs to be sent to the user. Now you may have noticed that link is within the context of a HTML tag, specifically an anchor tag. And that's important because we want to get this item from S3, but we want to send it to our users as a pre-signed URL. And we obviously don't want like this big authenticated link, if you've ever seen a pre-signed URL before, being in the body of our email file. So we just tuck that away in a link. We'll set an expiration date so that they can access it, whether it be an hour, multiple hours, however you want to do it. It's up to you, but it is a user nonetheless receiving this item. Now, for the purposes of this application, my SES account is in the sandbox mode, so I can only send to verified users. If you want the ability to send to anybody, just let me know, drop a comment. I can walk you through or create another video on how to get production access for your SES account. But these are going to be the primary actors today. We are going to be using an SES API instead of our Lambda function, but only thing left is to verify this webhook and get everything underway. Let's walk through the code and I'll show you exactly how I did it. All right, now I did want to gloss over this, but before we actually jump into the code, I want to show you how to create this registration form. So you go to tally.so, I believe. Yeah, tally.so. Once you log in, they give you, I think they say 99% of their services for free. I went ahead and created a basic registration form. This is what it looks like when you come over to edit it. Super basic. We have a first name. We have an email. The reason why I want to point this out though is because of two things. One, when you click on this input box, these dots right here, you can change what shows up. By default, it just says name, but you might want to customize your fields. So this is the name tag that would be on an input field. I'm specifically calling this first name so that way I can access it inside of my code. Same thing for the email. Click on these dots. I'm specifically calling it lowercase email as opposed to, I think by default, it's capital email. And then on the sort of thank you page, you can always reference any one of these fields by putting an at sign in front of here. So if I come over here and get rid of this, then I can just say thanks. But if I put an at, then it'll pull up those fields. And this is really cool in making sure that I get interpolated item inside of there. All right, but that's all we have for here. I'm going to head over to the code and walk you through what we have going on. So first and foremost, we want to include this script. And I guess I maybe gloss over this, but if you come back over here and you have this registration form and you publish it, but once you click on publish, you can then share it. And when you click on share, it'll take you over to this page. I am choosing to have a standard embed. And when I get the code, I just came down here to using JavaScript. And now I have the script tag that I want to embed as well as the iframe that I need. This load embeds, I didn't use that at all. All good. React Helmet is used to get our application up and running ahead of time. And then I tuck in that script tag so that way this all loads before the rest of my code does. Straightforward stuff. And the reason why I want to get that embed working is because over in my components, as I mentioned, I have the different components here, but the hero is the only one with actual content that we care about. The iframe in particular is going to take that Tally code. And this is just what I copied over from Tally. I tucked it away in here, gave it a name, and I have a very super simple way to display form inside of my application. Now you might be curious, what kind of React application are we working with? I went with just straight up Vite for this application. It's a single page, it's all client side, and it gets the job done very quickly. From there, we can go over to the Amplify stuff. In case you haven't checked it out, Amplify Gen 2 is a game changer. It's way different from Amplify Gen 1. And you get this cool little sandbox. And the sandbox will look at your backend, put it in an ephemeral environment, so that way you can deploy things locally without having to worry about stomping on teammates' workflows or other things like that. 2 steps to get that up and running. You want to run npm create Amplify. And this is Amplify init in Gen 1. It will scaffold out your application. It comes with data and auth out of the box. I deleted those because I don't need those in this project. But after running that command, then you can start your sandbox. This is going to be npx, ampx sandbox. And this will get everything up and running for you. This isn't going to work for me because I don't have my credentials. Yeah, I don't have my credentials logged in. But once you do that, it'll get your application going. From here, we know that we need 2 services. We need our Lambda function and we need our S3 bucket. All of that is going to take place inside of this Amplify functions and storage area. And the main file for this is going to be this backend folder or backend file. So we have our backend right here inside of this defined backend object. And at face value, this is all you need. Like all this other stuff, we'll get into that. These are just the permissions. But this right here is core. So we're just going to break these pieces apart to see what they look like. But let's kick things off with probably storage. That's going to be the easiest service that you can get set up. And it looks like this. This is creating an S3 bucket in my account. So I give it a name and I tell it what has access to it. I'm saying that I want to allow my webhook that I haven't shown you yet, but we'll get to that. I want to allow this webhook to have the ability to read from this bucket. Where do I want you to read from? The songs folder / and then any item inside of that folder. I can specify this to be the specific item, but I think this is good enough. And this is crazy to me because in 5 lines of code, we have an S3 bucket with access granted to a specific item. It's super cool. So let's head over to our function because that's the start of the show and I'll show you what that looks like. So as you can see, everything takes place in a resource file. If I want to create a function, it's a function / resource.ts. Same thing with storage / resource.ts. Function is the same thing. We have our tally webhook. This is what we're going to provide to tally. And then we are going to have an entry point. I named mine main.ts. You can see on the right-hand side here, we have a main.ts. This is our entry point. We can also pass it environment secrets. Now I'm using 2 forms of secrets here. I have this tally secret, which is like an actual secret. I don't want anybody to see this. You all can't see it. And when I add it into my AWS account, I can't even see it. It's just copy and paste it along the way. And then I have environment variables. These are things that I just want to parameterize inside of my Lambda function to make them a little bit more generic. In my case, things are going to be accessed on process.env. Song path verified SES from email. This is the email that the email is coming from. So it's coming from me. And then this is going to be the path to where my song is inside of my S3 bucket. Now, how did I add this secret? Easy enough. I'm over here in the Amplify documentation. I was like, yeah, AMPX secret. And then I went to set and then you give it the secret name. And this is what I was talking about where I can't even see the secret. You just have to paste it in and it'll get saved into your account. And you access it from this secret module coming from the backend libraries. And this is exactly what we're doing inside of our Lambda function. Okay, so back over to the code. We are going to automatically have this secret inside of here. I already know that it's working. I got this from Tally. Again, I'll show you how I got that and where I put in the webhook URL towards the end. But looking back at our architecture diagram, you can see what we have here. We have our secret, we have the song path, and we have the email. Let's take a peek at that architecture just to make sure we're on the right track. Where we have our Lambda function, we still have to show you how to get the webhook URL. We have the S3 bucket, and we've shown how to grant access to our Lambda function. We know about this MP3 file, right? No big deal there. And then we need permission for our Lambda function to effectively send this email to our user. Right. Taking a peek at our code, how do we bridge those pieces together? Not too bad. Let's talk about creating the webhook function URL first. And the way that you do that is to head over to your backend.ts. This is your entry point for where all of your backend stuff is happening. Now, in my case, I went ahead and I accessed all of the items inside of our backend through this backend variable. And the cool thing is that because it's all built in TypeScript, I get backend dot, and then I get IntelliSense out of the box. Pretty cool. So the things that I want to do is one, create a function URL, which is what I'm doing right here, right? Set the auth type to none. We don't need to worry about cores or anything like that either, because we are not in a browser server environment. It's just straight up server to server. And then for the policies that our function has, we need to give it the ability to send an email in a raw email using SES. Now we don't have to add the permission that's already given to us back over in our storage resource file. This automatically configures that permission for us. Cool. Last thing is because this is just a thin layer on top of the AWS CDK, we also want to output the name of our function URL. That's how we do it. Nothing too crazy. So we have our policies and permissions in place. Now let's piece everything together over in our main file here. Now that's going to be the star of the show. We have to bring in those environment variables that we configured back in our functions resource file. Now this utility right here will automatically read all of those. In fact, if I do env dot, you can see all of the environment variables that are available to me including things like Access Secret Keys. And then at the bottom, we'll get to the bottom here, we have the verified SES from, we have the Tyler signature, the bucket name, song path, etc. These are all the things that we care about. And we're using those inside of our application. Now, I don't know if you have context on verifying webhook URLs, but oftentimes they're not fun, despite them being very much the same. It doesn't matter if it's like a Stripe webhook, Square webhook, or in this case, a Tally webhook. Now, they oftentimes will give you the code on how to do it. You just want to make sure, especially because our function URL isn't protected in any way, you want to make sure that whoever is calling this is in fact just Tally. So when Tally invokes our webhook URL, they're going to pass along an encrypted signature, right? And our job is to decrypt it and make sure that it matches the unique string that we have with Tally. So they give us something encrypted, we decrypt it and say, does it match what we have on our end? Easy enough. I have a utility function called verified Tally that will take in the body, the headers, which is where that signature lives, and then the unique signature string that we're trying to verify it is. Let's take a look at what that looks like. This verified Tally webhook is, I don't know, 15 lines of code, 20, and that's including the types and all that good stuff. Effectively, what we're doing is saying we need to calculate this stuff, the signature, and just compare it. If it's the same, go ahead and return the payload and say that it's validated. Otherwise, kick the person out because they're not coming from Tally and they don't need to be inside of our function to do any other processing. The cool thing is that the Tally documentation gave me all of this. In no way could I just bring this out of my head. This is all given to me. But I tucked it away in a utility file because I love all of you. Back in our main code, now that we know that the payload is validated, we can say, hey, if that event type is of type form response, then we can process these fields. We'll take a look at what this process fields function does, but it's pretty much just the bulk of our application. In our case, we're going to find the specific fields on this form that we care about. Because who knows, we could have many. We just care about the first name in the email. So we're going to find the field where the label equals email, and we're going to get the value. It's going to be whatever email they put in. We're going to do the same thing for the first name and grab those values as well. So now we have them. Just for my own safekeeping and sanity, I am logging these values out. If you clone this repo and fork it, feel free to take out these console.logs. But then we're going to then get the song. Now, generating a pre-signed URL means getting the link to your item in S3 with a super long URL attached to it. It's basically authenticated based off of whatever permissions you have set up. Doing so, though, is pretty easy. So I split this out into another utility because I definitely use this and reuse it across projects. But I have a pre-signed URL file here over on the right-hand side. And all it does is take in the bucket, take in the key, and you tell it when you want this link to expire. And it does just that. There's a get signed URL module from S3, and you instantiate the client, and you pass in these specific items that it needs, and it will return to you a URL. Pretty easy, but it's worth keeping in its own file. Outside of here, now let's assume that worked, and I have the URL. I'm setting it to expire in 1 hour. Note that this is in seconds. Yeah, seconds. And I can send the email. Now, I already showed you how I can give my Lambda function access to send this email. Nothing too crazy going on there. But in this case, we are going to get the email that we're verified with, and we're going to pass it an array of people that want this email, this song. Next up, we have the title. And then from here, we have the body. I should really make this an object so it's easier to read, but you can see like the ordering as we go along. Who's sending it? Who's it being sent to? What is the title? What is the body? All this stuff is in place. And the cool thing is that, you know, using template literals, I can parameterize this with my specific HTML content. Now, to give you a little insight into what this file looks like, the sent HTML email, it is exactly what I told you in terms of the parameters that it needs passed in. And then I'm just constructing this based off of the send email API from the AWS SDK. So we stamp in everything that I just talked about, and then we send the email. If there is a data response back, great, we sent it. Otherwise, error out. And that's the application. This is just stitching everything together, as I mentioned. Maybe the last thing to show you is just how do you verify an email inside of SES. Let me show you what that looks like real quick when I log into my AWS account. Okay, so I'm logging in, I'm gonna do admin access, and I'll bump up the font for all of you. We'll go there, and we're effectively gonna go to SES, simple email service. Now, as I mentioned, I am in the sandbox for this account. I can only send 200 emails per day, and I can only send to verified users. Now on my end, if I go to identities right over here, you can see the verified identities that I have, right? It's just my Gmail account and my Focus Auto account. Once they're verified, you can send. So if you create a new identity, it can either be a domain or an email address. Then you type it in here. And then inside of here, you would click create identity. It'll send you an email. You click the link and you're verified. Nothing too crazy going on there. But again, if you want to see how to get production access set up on your account, just let me know. And I can definitely walk through all of that with you. And there you have it. It doesn't take a whole lot to get this set up, especially when you understand the moving parts and you can just fork the repo and get things going on your end. And it definitely avoids having to pay extra month for some kind of subscription model or some other SaaS when really the moving pieces are super small and I provide all the utility functions for you. But if you enjoyed this video, definitely like and subscribe. Definitely helps the channel out as I'm trying to grow it and be more productive on YouTube. My name is Michael Leando. I go by Focus Auditor everywhere. Thanks for checking out the channel. If you have any other ideas and future content, drop them in the comments below. I would love to hear your feedback. But until then, happy coding, and we'll check you all next time. Peace.